whatever you
distinguished. Ladies and gentlemen, honored guests, welcome to the ceremonial opening of the high-level segment of the 25th session of the Conference of the Parties, serving as the meeting of the parties to the Kyoto Protocol, and the second session of the Conference of the Parties, serving as a meeting of the parties to the Paris Agreement. This afternoon, we are honored to have with us Mr. Alejandro Sanz, a Spanish musician, singer, and composer. Mr. Petr Italas, Secretary General of the World Meteorological Organization. To Honor Excellence, Mr. Tijani Mohamed Bande, President of the United Nations General Assembly at its 74th session. And Your Honorable, Your Excellence, Mrs. Teresa Rivera, Mistress of Ecological Transition Government of Spain. Distinguished delegates, ladies and gentlemen, it is now my distinct pleasure to invite Mr. Alejandro Sanz to address this plenary. Mr. Sanz, you have the floor.
Yes. Muy buenos días.
A very good morning to you all.
My name is Alejandro Sanz. I'm a musician and a citizen of the world. My intention here is not to accuse, it's not to point the finger, it's not to clash with anyone, because I sincerely believe that we're all guilty when it comes to the critical time in which we find ourselves. We're also part of the solution. That is why my way of dealing with this is from the need that we all have to stand together, given the situation that personally terrifies me. We are on the point of no return. I want to have faith and trust in us, and I want to believe that we'll arrive in time to be able to reverse climate change. But at the same time, I realize that this is the last chance we have to make that a reality. We have to stop clashing and arguing, accusing each other mutually of irresponsibility. It's not a question of political color or who's responsible, it's you or is it me? No. It's a question of saving our common home. Sometimes my music dreams of your happiness, sometimes the planet dreams that we love it. And let me just mention a few verses when I talk about planets. Our Mother Earth deserves the warmest embrace, our best embrace. We have to search inside of us for the best that we have in our hearts, give the very best of ourselves as a species. That is why I'm not going to tell anybody what they have to do, but I will tell you what I'm going to do. I want to ensure that my polluting footprint is reduced to the maximum. That is why I'm going to be implementing a study of the quantity of CO2 produced by my concerts. It's the only way of mitigating with specific actions which will counteract such emissions. I'll do all I can to ensure my concerts have renewable energy as their basic principle, electric transport, non-polluting energy, anything we need to do put a brake on this. This is a commitment that I am entering into. I invite all of us to do the same to ensure our environmental footprint is zero or as close as possible to zero. I'd invite companies, governments, all of you as individuals to commit to this exercise to offset what we contaminate. I'd also encourage you to strong and decisive. We have to show ourselves that we are a smart species. After all, we're able to get a coherent and timely solution. Science, for decades, has given us the response and the solution, given evidence. So let's not wait and waste any more time. Let's be fair with the less privileged. You can't have an environmental transition without a fair and inclusive society. We're all on this planet. It doesn't belong to anybody in particular, and that is why we have to do this for our children. That is why I would beg you, think of our children and their grandchildren. Look at your own conscience and let's do something about this. We're ready to assume the consequences that are necessary and address the policies that have to be taken in order to reverse this. Humans have shown that they can adapt to change for the common good. I'd call on governments, legislators, don't be frightened about demanding sacrifices of us. I'd encourage governments to be more active, legislate for the planet's benefit. I think you'd be surprised as governments at the response of people. We want to have courageous leaders who, if you like, can put our confidence to the test. Not much time is left to implement these policies to protect our planet. And we know what to do, don't we? If we do, let's do it. And finally, a bit of an exercise, and think of the children that you once were. I remember how much I loved nature, animals as a child. I mean, how are we going to explain to the child that you were what we have done to the planet that you loved so much? What would the child inside you have said? I'd like to thank you for listening to me. I'd like to thank you for your efforts and the courage of those who really want to have a solution to save our planet. Thank you for this global speech. I'd like to thank Latin America and the Caribbean for really standing behind this struggle. We're all on the same side and we do have time. I believe we still have time. Sometimes I think of your happiness, your courage, as well as the planet that we love. The world's eyes are turned on us. Let us not disappoint it.
Thank you, Mr. Sanz. Ladies and gentlemen, It is now my distinct pleasure to invite Mr. Petteri Tallas, Secretary General of the World Meteorological Organization, to address this plenary.
Dear Ministers Schmid and Ribera, dear President Mohamed Bande, dear Patricia, Ministers, Friends of Climate. First of all, I would like to congratulate the governments of Chile and Spain for very rapid conversion of this facility from Santiago to Madrid, and this has been a great success story. Thanks for your great work, and the support of UNFCCC has been also great in that sense. We have just published two new science reports, one for the United Nations Global Climate Action Summit in New York, and one last week on the status of climate, and those are not very good news. We have shown that warming continues. We have so far seen 1.1 degree warming in the atmosphere. We have warmed oceans by half degree so far. And last year we had 220 million people who were suffering from heat waves. Those were having health impacts. We have started seeing growth in hunger once again, although there was a decline in the past. And now we have more than 800 million people who are suffering from lack of food. This warming of the oceans has given more energy for tropical storms, and we have seen some record-breaking storms like Idai, which was hitting Mozambique, Zimbabwe and Malawi earlier this year, and that was the strongest cyclone hitting southern hemisphere in 100 years. We have also seen a strong typhoon hitting Japan, and also Hurricane Dorian was hitting the Caribbean islands, and Bahamas lost 25% of its annual GDP in one day. At the moment, we have severe fires going on in Sydney area in Australia. We have a lack of water in Victoria Falls, flooding in East Africa, and also we have seen flooding here in southern part of Europe. Arctic continues to melt, and we have seen a boost in melting of the Greenland glacier, which is contributing to the sea level rise, especially in southern hemisphere. And the changes in the Arctic, they have had impacts on weather patterns outside of the Arctic. Some of the unusual cold winter patterns and heat waves outside of the Arctic, they are related to the follow-up of the Arctic climate changes. We have broken records in three main greenhouse gases, carbon dioxide, methane and nitrous oxide. And out of those, carbon dioxide is of course the most important one. And we are more or less moving towards 3 to 5 degrees warming by the end of this century. And if we use all of the known fossil fuel resources, we would reach 8 degrees warmer planet. At the moment, we produce 85% of the global energy based on coal, oil and gas, and only 15% based on nuclear, hydro or renewables. We have the means to solve this problem by converting our energy systems to become more based on nuclear, hydro and renewables. We have also means in transportation sector. And many of the young people especially have been asking that we should do something tomorrow. But on the other hand, we have to be realistic. We have still some time to convert our systems, but things should happen in the coming 10 to 30 years to be successful in implementation of the Paris Agreement. There's growing pressure to talk about carbon taxes, which may put pressure on emitters, and also the consumers are more and more interested in knowing what is the carbon footprint of the products that they are buying. So that's putting pressure on those of you who have lots of fossil-based fleet. At political level, it's great that besides ministries for environment, we have now growing interest among the ministers and ministries of finance to be players in this game. And it would be also further widened to transport sector and industry sectors. But on the other hand, you have to face political realities. If you are too extreme in your action, then it may have negative political implications. So finally, as a father of five children, and I'm also expecting to see fairly soon grandchildren, I think that we should move towards thinking of economic growth next year from to longer perspectives, and that's what we really need. And besides climate mitigation, one should talk more about population growth. We have more consumers because of that, and we have also more people who are suffering because of climate change. And finally, I would like to say that this conversion is a business opportunity, and there will be winners in this game, and I hope that that the winners will be heard much more in the future. With these words, thanks for listening to me, and I would like to wish you a successful COP25 meeting. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Stalla, for your statement. Ladies and gentlemen, I now have the pleasure to invite Her Excellency Mr. Teresa Rivera, Minister of Ecological Transition Government of Spain, to address this plenary.
Buenos días.
Very good morning, dear President. Good morning, Executive Secretary. Good morning.
Darles la bienvenida en Madrid de la
To welcome you to the high-level segment.
Quiero dar las gracias.
I'd like to start by thanking the Presidency of Chile and the UN for placing trust in Spain to organize this climate summit and making this possible. This is a very important process. We're building this together in order to ensure climate security. And I'd also like to thank you all. Thank you all for participating, for your commitment to multilateralism at a very crucial point. Also, thanks to those who are not in the room this morning, but you were out in the streets on the 6th. I have spent 20 years of my personal and professional life in order to combat climate change, sometimes with important personal cost. I have to say it's been amazing and moving to see how this is a real social outcry that we're seeing. People want more action. They want it to be faster. They want it to go further. Something that I think should spark serious soul searching. Are we governments, institutions that are actually being left behind? Are we? No. We have to really be up to expectations and challenges. This is something that has been marked by cooperation, the capacity of the international community to rise to the challenge even during difficult periods with solidarity. The message is crystal clear in that regard. We are not going to lower our guard. We are committed to the climate agenda. We're committed to multilateralism, committed to providing a response to the profound consequences of this, because there is inequity, also in terms of well-being, welfare, economics. This is a huge challenge that we have. It's true that some people are looking at this in short-term views, overly local. This is wrong. This is wrong. We cannot just remain looking at the short term. We need activist responses which integrate the medium term, long-term solidarity, and the ability to share responses. You can't just look the other way. We have to be militants. We have to be climate activists. We need to do more, and we need to do it and speed up our action. These conferences tend to establish important rules for common action, but it mustn't just remain at that stage. We need action. That's what people are asking us to do. We're being asked, how are we changing? What are we doing to promote this, given young people want us to be clear and decisive? It's terrible when you look at the environmental program, they've told us that we've lost 10 years. But at the same time, we have a challenge, but it's a hopeful challenge on what we're hearing from the IPCC in the sense that we have got 10 years also to avoid climate change. You may remember what the commitment was 4 years ago in Paris, that we wouldn't go beyond 1.5 degrees. That's possible. We actually believe we can do that by 2050 in Europe, building a new model of prosperity built on conclusion and inclusion and equity. And it's based on centering it on people, their concerns, their future, decisions that will have consequences for their future. The social dimension of climate change is obvious, and it's staring us in the face as well. We have to look at resilience. We have to look at individuals. There is a real demand for climate justice between and across countries, between and across generations, but also within our current generation, women, girls, the vulnerable, people who are in settlements, people who are in vulnerable areas, and they don't want to fall by the wayside. They don't want to be left behind. We have to facilitate. We have to facilitate equity, justice. We can't do it alone. We need society. We need businesses. We need activists. We need people coming out on the streets. We need science. The scientists understand us and help us and guide us. This is a different COP, a different one. We need dynamism from civil society. We need more action. This is something which have implications on and in our work. We need to ensure that the climate agenda is cross-cutting when it comes to implementation. It's inclusive. We make the boast of science. You can't question science here. We don't have time to lose pointlessly questioning the science. And look at what's happening in Madrid now. I'm particularly happy to see that the Chilean government has shown such commitment. They've ensured that sectoral ministers responsible for fundamental areas have come together and that they've coordinated and facilitated debate and a strategic vision with their colleagues and with fundamental players in the private sector in order to speed up action. That is the best way of doing this. It's time to act. That's the slogan. It's the best slogan. And we need to project this message. We've got to be forthright in that regard, and that we build bridges for all generations, forging those links to ensure that all this becomes a reality. It's not just a question of making more official communications, not just that. We need to be convincing in what we say. And this is something that we need to ensure by 2020, more ambition for all, in line with our capacities, more ambition in mitigation, more ambition in resilience, adapting to the effects of climate change, more ambitious contributions by 2020. 2020, as we know, is in 20 days' time, exactly. A year in which we need to ensure we have climate neutrality. The steps taken by many small countries have been very important countries, as well as the medium and the bigger countries in terms of their climate action. Private actors as well, who have wanted to ensure that they're acting differently. The Secretary General, just a week ago in Madrid, made this point. The major economies also have to move. We also need to raise our commitments. Our responsibility is not just to our compatriots. Of course, what is done by the bigger countries has an impact on the planet. This is something which means we need to protect mobilization, involve NGOs, bring on board cities and regions. But we all need to do more. We cannot backtrack on this. That's not tolerable. Nor can we stand silent, waiting for others to act. We need to also finish our negotiations in this conference. naturally. But this is also a blue COP. Chile wanted to make this a blue COP. The IPCC's panel says there's a close relationship between oceans and the climate. It's a sort of thermostat, if you like. Biodiversity as well. It's a fragile space, the oceans, but vital for our survival. It moderates and regulates the climate. It's an excellent opportunity to highlight the synergies and the mutual benefits between the biodiversity policies we have, climate, and the blue economy, to work together on something that will continue to be a main plank of our work in the international year, particularly next year in China. We can reverse climate change. We can build resilience, ensure that 30% of marine spaces are protected by 2030. This is an excellent idea. We want to be climate neutral by 2050 as a country and reduce one out of every three tons before 2030. Bank on renewable energies by 2030. We want 40% renewable, improve our energy and consumption efficiency as well. This is based on science. It's based on social demand as well. Prosperity, innovation, employment, health, and education and innovation can all factor in cross-cutting in our combating of climate change. This is underpinning the government's action. This is going to have an impact on our resources. There are some sensitive resources for all of us, for instance, water and our coastal areas. We have to set priorities. We have to identify the most relevant impacts for each of our societies. In our case, water is particularly sensitive. We have to preserve our water resources, save our water resources. Our coast also needs to be better planned. We're marine facing, if you like, and that is why we need to preserve by 2030 the maximum of our marine resources. All these areas, I think, illustrate there are great advantages if we have nature-based solutions. We are pioneering when it comes to social challenges and addressing them. We believe that such a huge transformation cannot be done turning the back on those who feel threatened by climate change. We believe in the opportunities that may exist if we address this in time in order to overcome the obstacles. We're convinced that it's not just our responsibility. It's an economic imperative. It's a social imperative, as it is for humanity. The only way of building a prosperous future based on ambition. And there, we all have to see ourselves reflected in that ambition. Thank you.
Muchas gracias, Teresa.
Many thanks, Teresa.
Ladies and gentlemen, it is my pleasure now to invite the Secretary General of the Climate Change Secretariat, Mrs. Patricia Espinosa, to address this floor. Patricia, you have the floor.
Thank you, Madam President. Good morning to everyone, excellencies, ministers, honorable guests, delegates. I begin by thanking the governments of Chile and Spain for working together in the spirit of inclusive multilateralism to make this COP25 possible. While we may not be physically in Latin America and the Caribbean region, its spirit and leadership steer these discussions. Quiero darle las gracias también.
I'd also particularly like to thank the people of Spain, and particularly the Madrileños, for welcoming us here and opening up the doors of your home and indeed of your hearts to more than 25,000 participants who have decided to come and visit you this month, the month of your fiestas as well, as I know. Many thanks for that.
We have had a productive first week, and an ambitious schedule remains. This high-level segment of COP25 is especially important. Secretary General Guterres said last week that humanity faces two paths, one of surrender and one of hope. The scientific evidence overwhelmingly shows that we are not on the right path. Instead, we are going in the wrong direction. The IPCC reports that the Latin American and Caribbean region has warmed 0.7 degrees Celsius between 0.7 and 1 degree Celsius since 1970. Nations there have been among the most impacted by extreme weather events, including Honduras, Haiti, Dominica, and Nicaragua, setting some economies back decades. In 2019, Hurricane Dorian smashed into the Bahamas, leaving a trail of devastation throughout the region, a monster storm that Secretary General described as category hell. Drought conditions are worsening existing challenges in the region, such as increased hunger, growing poverty, and forcing migration. It is one region in a world facing a climate emergency. Last year, we received three reports from the IPCC telling us we are poisoning the very elements that keep us alive on this planet. Meanwhile, governments continue to subsidize fossil fuel industries. Our overall consumption habits have little changed, and the UNEP-GAP report show that emissions continue to rise. We are not acting quickly enough to enact the deep transformation throughout society that will save humanity's future on this planet. This year marks the 25th anniversary of UN climate change. Each year at the COP, we're told that the window of opportunity could close soon. Ministers, dear friends, the window of opportunity is closing now. On both a professional and personal level, my message to all of you is this. We need your decisions. We need your leadership. We are out of time. I remain optimistic. Let us not forget that the Paris Agreement, a covenant of hope with the people of the world, entered into force ahead of schedule, in record time, and remains an unprecedented multilateral success story. Last year's adoption of its work program began to unleash the power of the Paris Agreement, allowing nations to focus on implementation and building climate ambition. Because of your work, the cornerstones of the Paris Agreement are in place and fully functional. We look to the constituted bodies, such as the Consultative Group of Experts, the Coronavia Joint Work on Agriculture, and the Katowice Committee of Experts on the impacts of implementation of response measures. Transparency has been boosted. The Paris Agreement and the Katowice package laid out a clear roadmap for the transition by parties to the Enhanced Transparency Framework, the EFT, after 2020. Several developing countries have started planning for the implementation of the ETF, and we've seen a rise in national transparency reports. We've also seen progress with respect to REDD+, which was not only incorporated into the Paris Agreement, but is now flourishing. It moved from just a negotiated concept to a fully functioning funding and capacity building tool of the Convention and the Paris Agreement. Transparency has built trust. The Green Climate Fund has, in 2019, provided REDD+ results-based payments amounting to $229 million, with more in the pipeline for 2020. And most elements under Article 12 are already complete and functioning. This includes the Indigenous and Local Communities Platform, the Gender Platform, and ACE, which empowers youth and the public to take climate action. the Paris Agreement is operational and delivering on its promise. But important work remains. You are tasked with finalizing Article 6 here at COP25 to make it complete. We know that ambition and action to address the climate emergency is needed in every part of the economy. Article 6 of the Paris Agreement is essential to responding to that urgent need. It is the only part of the Paris Agreement that directly engages with the private sector, helping them to contribute to climate action and ultimately to the implementation of NDCs. And Article 6 is designed so that mitigation under its umbrella can help to also increase support to adaptation. This will help address the persistent imbalance between mitigation and adaptation finance. Operationalizing Article 6 will also help get carbon markets up and running in support of the Paris Agreement and ensure that the rules are the same for everyone. Failure to operationalize Article 6 risks fragmenting those markets and sends a negative message that can undermine our overall climate efforts. Ministers, we recognize that a lot of technical work on this issue will remain for the future, but an agreement here in Madrid is crucial. We've made progress in the last few days, but we need to push on to finalize our work. 2020 is only a few weeks away, the year when we must see more climate ambition reflected in new and revised NDCs. Without them, our window of opportunity closes. Let us then achieve a successful outcome here in Madrid, and let us forge a new path, a better path, a path of hope to 2020 and beyond. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Patricia, for your words. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like now to invite His Excellency, Mr. Tijani Mohamed Bande, President of the United Nations General Assembly, at his 34th session to address our meeting. Your Excellency, you have the floor.
Your Excellency, this is Colonel Schmidt, Minister of Environment of Chile and President of COP25. Your Excellency, Mrs. Teresa Rivera Rodriguez, Minister of Ecological Transition. Your Excellency, Mrs. Patricia Espinoza, Executive Secretary of the UNFCCC. Mr. Petrelli Talas, Secretary General of the World Meteorological Organization. Mr. Alejandro Sanz. Excellencies, Honorable Ministers, ladies and gentlemen, I'm honored to address the 25th Conference of the Parties to the UNFCCC COP25. I commend Minister Smith for her able leadership in steering our deliberations. I thank the Government of Spain for its superb hosting of the conference at short notice. I also thank the Secretariat of the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change for organizing it. Excellencies, 4 years ago, world leaders adopted the only universally binding agreement to address the climate threat. This was a feat of multilateralism which began in embryonic form as a General Assembly resolution. The normative development of climate action reached its pinnacle in Paris. By adopting the Paris Climate Agreement, we have committed to limit global warming. We reached consensus to limit the rise in temperature to 2 degrees above pre-industrial levels and committed to pursuing efforts to hold it to 1.5 degrees Celsius. Current trends of global emissions will cause further warming, and humans will face severe and extreme weather events. Recurrent climate disasters are becoming global and are, of course, borderless. It is already causing unprecedented human and socioeconomic costs. The progress made in reducing global poverty and improving people's lives and livelihoods are threatened. Lands are being degraded. Forests, ecosystems, and biodiversity are being lost. Our oceans are facing pollution, acidification, and loss of coastal habitats. Excellencies, the latest World Meteorological Organization report informs us that the global average temperature has already increased by 1.1 degrees centigrade since the pre-industrial period. We know that commitments made in the context of the nationally determined contributions, NDCs, are not enough to keep global temperature at the agreed threshold. Failing to raise global ambition will put us on track for a 3 degrees or 4 degrees temperature rise. This is would be a catastrophe. It is imperative that we deliver significant results now. Global emissions need to peak fast and to be immediately cut down significantly. Indeed, science is unequivocal on the urgency to act, both at global and national levels. According to the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, IPCC, solutions still exist if we act urgently and boldly. Any delay will come at a high cost to everyone, everywhere. Over the last 5 years, economic losses by extreme weather conditions were estimated at about $572 billion. This year, Hurricane Dorian alone cost an estimated $3.5 billion worth of damage to the Bahamas. We need to take collective action now. We must partner with leaders of cities and local authorities, business, NGOs, indigenous groups, and civil society to take climate action at national and global levels. We must address the mitigation gap and review our individual and collective NDCs to ensure that they are integrated into policies and budgets across all sectors. Many countries demonstrated leadership at the Climate Action Summit by making commitments to scale up their NDCs by 2020 and achieve carbon neutrality by mid-century. I encourage all other member states to emulate them in order to ensure a better world for all. Excellencies, distinguished delegates, we need an economic model that provides for prosperity for all, while dissociating economic growth from environmental degradation. To dramatically change our consumption and production patterns, we must invest in a structural shift in global energy, transport, food production, and urban systems. Cities contribute more than 70% of global emissions. We need to practice climate-conscious decision-making in terms of planning, transport, and energy efficiency when it comes to our cities and urban infrastructure. We need to build on the low-carbon energy sources which are developing around the world. I'm passionate about reaching zero hunger and have set this as a priority for the 74th session of the United Nations General Assembly. This involves not only production and consumption, but solidarity as well. I am concerned about the 1 in 4 economically active women engaged in agriculture who bear the brunt of climate change. Their issues are our issues, and this must be mainstreamed in all we do. Women's issues cannot be an afterthought. We need to improve our food systems so that they are sustainable and inclusive. This begins with climate-smart agricultural systems which can withstand climate shocks. Investing in resilience and adaptation measures is crucial, particularly for the most vulnerable countries and communities. Some of these communities have already experienced devastating impacts of climate change, and we know that further effects are imminent. We must act now to safeguard lives, livelihoods, and homes of the peoples we serve. Excellencies, implementing the Paris Agreement and ensuring a transition to resilient low-carbon economies requires the mobilization of a broad range of public, private, international, and domestic financial resources and investments. Developed countries agreed to support climate action in developing countries by mobilizing $100 billion per annum by their 2020. The deadline is fast approaching. I commend those who have made pledges in favor of climate finance. However, the funds remain low. We need to expedite the catalyzation of all financing flows to meet the growing demands for both adaptation and mitigation. There have been positive trends in green investments as renewables are becoming much cheaper and more accessible. We must capitalize on this momentum. Climate action is not a philanthropic endeavor. It is also a means to boost economic growth, to create jobs, and to improve livelihoods worldwide. Climate action can lead to a net economic gain of $26 trillion by 2030. According to the ARENA Global Energy Transformation Report, energy transformation alone would result in 11.6 million jobs. Excellencies, the United Nations Climate Change Conference presents us with the opportunity to forge partnerships, deepen alliances, and build momentum at a crucial juncture on the road to 2030. Both the September 2019 Climate Action Summit convened by the Secretary General and the SDG Summit convened under the auspices of the United Nations General Assembly offered us an opportunity to assess the level of progress achieved and to mobilize support at the highest political level. They've also set the pace for the decade of action and delivery. We must work together to ensure that no one is left behind, especially those farthest behind. I call on all world leaders to work to reverse the loss of biodiversity and to protect and restore nature. According to the latest reports of the IPCC and the Intergovernmental Science Policy Platform on Biodiversity and Ecosystem Services, biodiversity loss is accelerating dramatically, with 1 million species at risk of extinction in the coming decades. Current trends in biodiversity and ecosystem will undermine the long-term resilience of the world's most vulnerable people as we are not achieving progress towards 80% of the assessed SDG targets relating to poverty, hunger, health, water, climate, and land. In 2020, the United Nations General Assembly will convene an important biodiversity summit ahead of COP15 in China. We are setting this stage and expect us to act. Excellencies, our oceans are heavily affected by human activities, including pollution, overfishing, and loss of coastal habitats and acidification. The General Assembly is convening the second Ocean Conference in Lisbon in June. The conference aims to galvanize multilateral action to reverse current negative trends and to protect the health of our oceans and livelihoods. I will convene a high-level dialogue to assess the progress made in the fight against desertification, land degradation, and drought. It is alarming that every year the world loses 2.4 billion tons of fertile soil. Action is needed to restore degraded land. These seminal events will provide you with a platform to invest in nature-based solutions that contribute to reducing emissions, increasing resilience, and improving livelihoods. These actions result in crucial co-benefits in the overall strategy to achieve the 2030 agenda. Excellencies, the United Nations will mark its 75th anniversary in 2020. As always, it remains committed to ensuring peace and development and the protection of human rights throughout the world. We are duty-bound to eradicate poverty, address inequalities, tackle climate change, prevent conflict, sustain peace, and uphold human rights in the name of the people we serve. As we celebrate the 75th anniversary of the United Nations, we must strengthen our rules-based international order. Clearly, the solutions to our current challenges, including climate emergency, will only be found through collective action and equality of voice. Excellencies, the responsibilities for solutions fall upon each and every one of us. To ignore the impact of climate change would be to fail the peoples of the world and future generations. Neither a small island developing state nor a large member state can hold back the wave of climate change alone. We need to take collective action. Risk reduction measures have the potential to safeguard up to 280 million people at risk of displacement due to sea level rise. It is our decision to go down with this ship or to change course immediately. This is the time to act. We are determined, we are defined by our actions. And every day we have a moral obligation to take action in favor of the next generation and beyond. I'm confident we'll rise to this challenge. I thank you.
Thank you, Excellency, for your statement. I will now address the plenary. Estimado,
distinguished ministers, delegates, friends, welcome to COP25, the Conference of Parties to the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change. And it is a great honor for me and also a great responsibility for me to preside over this conference. Thank you for being here. Thank you for your commitment. It's a necessary commitment. It's an urgent commitment. It is only by standing together and acting together, only by doing that can we square up to the greatest common challenge that we are facing today, climate change. I'd particularly like to thank Spain, Prime Minister Sanchez, Minister Teresa Ribera, and all the teams, all the Spanish citizens. Thank you. Thank you for welcoming us and hosting this. Thank you for having acted in such a generous fashion, showing so much solidarity with Chile. You have given an example to the world of how, with working together, you can make possible what we thought at one moment would be impossible. We're assuming the presidency of COP25, representing Latin America and the Caribbean. Our countries are facing social, economic, and environmental emergencies which are different to those of the developed states. We are conveying the voice of more than 50 million citizens in our region. Women, children, the elderly, entire communities which are severely suffering from the effects of global warming, droughts, fires, deluges, floods, which are hitting very hard both our territories and our people. The social crisis that we are going through in many countries of our region, as well as the environmental crisis affecting the whole world, are the crises of the 21st century. They are two sides of the same coin. You cannot address one without dealing with the other. Climate change is unfair, unjust. It affects more severely those communities and territories that are more vulnerable. And it has a knock-on effect. It is something which exacerbates already existing inequities. And that is why, because climate change is unfair, we want climate action to be fair. This is the voice of hope that I'd like to bring to COP. It's a COP which enables us to really change course. COP25 is the first one prior to the implementation of the Paris Agreement. This COP must mark a real change of course. A change of course, a change of direction in our ambition, bringing on board new players to the table. Regional governments, local governments, citizen communities, the private sector, both productive and financial. Because committed to carbon neutrality by 2050, as per the science, because climate action is not, and it must not be, just a political issue. National commitments are necessary, yes, but they're not sufficient. We have to bring on board everyone. We need all of you. A change of course, taking us from negotiation to action. Mainstreaming climate action into all productive sectors, making them part of the solution. That is why, for the very first time in this COP, we've had high-level meetings with the ministers of science, the ministers of agriculture, the ministers of finance and energy and treasury. They're the ones who, if you like, hold the purse strings. They have committed to also carbon neutrality 2050. A change of course, which allows us to bring on board new topics for climate action. This is a blue COP. Oceans cover two-thirds of our planet. They are essential both for mitigation and for adaptation to climate change. That is why we will be promoting the incorporation of sustainable management and protection of oceans in countries' NDCs. A change of course also to change science into a key ally, not in terms of diagnosis alone, but in terms of getting the solutions, innovation, technology transfer, capacity buildings, and nature-based solutions. These are all key for a more ambitious climate action, one that is more rapid and one that is more effective. And finally, a change of course in terms of what society really wants from us, and perhaps the one that has been the hardest for us to listen to and hear, inclusion. This convention is 25 years old. It took us 25 years to understand what we should be doing in order to address climate change. And we managed to do that. The challenge now is to define how we do it. How do we implement the solutions properly? And I think we will only find a response to that amongst people. We need to promote fair transition, leaving no one behind, a transition which will consider not only the workers, but also the most vulnerable citizens. They are the ones who have felt that their voice hasn't been heard. They are the ones which we have to ensure there is a change of course for. And we need to let them know how we are bringing about this transformation so that we have sustainable development, low in emissions and climate resilient. As we usher in the high level segment of this COP25, I'd like to guarantee to you all the deepest commitment that my presidency have with each and every of the parties to find solutions which can be acceptable to all. These solutions have to be real progress on the path to implementing the Convention, the Kyoto Protocol, as well as the Paris Agreement. These solutions also have to be mindful of the pre-2020 commitment, those commitments already complied with, and the implementation that we need in order to advance with ambition as of 2020. It's also important to be mindful of the fact that developing countries are ready to implement tangible actions. However, there needs to be clarity in terms of means of implementation, considering both funding as well as capacity building and development and technology transfer. That is precisely why we have particularly stressed climate finance and adaptation. We are conducting high-level dialogue with the climate finance ministers, and we'll be having an unprecedented high-level dialogue on adaptation. Our doors are open to ensure that the process is inclusive, that it's balanced and transparent, whereby all parties have an opportunity to participate, bearing in mind the particular conditions of the more vulnerable countries. And I want to be crystal clear here. The world has its eyes turned on us, and they hope that they will provide us with tangible answers. Climate crisis is a reality, and the citizens of the world are well aware of that because they live it every day. Every measure we take, every commitment we enter into is a step. It's a step of hope. The planet needs us to stand united and also to stand more committed than ever. Ladies and gentlemen, I invite you to be part of the solution. I invite you to be part of this change of course, to turn this hope for a better world into a reality, because today is time for action. Many thanks.
Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, this brings us to the end of the ceremonial opening of the high-level segment. May I ask you to remain in your seats to allow our special guests on the podium to leave. We are truly honored to have had them here with us today. Thank you a lot.